Welcome to the Lisa Saunders Show. Today I'm going to be putting myself through a little bit of a workout, not too much, but I am having somebody here who wants me to do some exercises, and you too. But she's only brought the easy exercises for today, she's going to tell us about herself. Welcome, Donna Anderson.
Thank you, Lisa. Thank you so much for having me on the show. I'm absolutely thrilled to be here. And I promise I won't even get you sweaty today.
Okay, because I'm wearing a skirt, so when I saw some of those exercises, you're going to let me do an easier way.
I am. We're going to modify it for the chair so Lisa feels comfortable in every which way. And just remember, you can take these exercises, you can do them standing up, you can do them on the floor. We modify them actually to suit the client.
Well, tell me what your business is, what you own, where you are, just so people know.
Right. So my name is Donna Anderson, as you said, and I am the founder and executive director of Encore Fitness and Wellness, LLC. And our business is in Westerly, Rhode Island at 271 Post Road. That's the Spindrift Village. And the same village where the Sea Goose is going up towards Charlestown. So not too far for anybody down here in Groton or Mystic. It's really very accessible.
Well, that's great. So when did you start this?
Actually, I started the business last April, and I was working out of my home, primarily going to clients' homes.
Oh, and making an exercise. But you're not just exercise. Explain to me, what is Encore Fitness and Wellness? What is it?
Well, it's a medical exercise practice, but it actually encompasses many things. So I have a background in both pharmaceuticals and nutrition. And I'm certified by the ACSM.
And what's ACSM?
It's the American College of Sports Medicine.
Okay.
So I not only can write exercise prescriptions for clients, but I also can do their nutritional assistance, provide them with diets if they need to lose weight, or even with a diabetic, I can help keep their blood sugar at the proper level.
So you can write the prescription?
Well, I don't write it. It's an exercise prescription, mind you. I'm not a doctor, so I don't write a pharmaceutical prescription. I can review their drugs and see if there's any drug-to-drug interaction that we should be concerned about.
Oh, okay.
And there's sometimes some medications are impacted by foods such as grapefruit. So oftentimes I'll look at a list of drugs and someone will say, well, I love grapefruit juice. And I'm like, well, if you're taking grapefruit juice, this drug is not working for you.
Okay, and you also know about, like, they should have sun exposure. I mean,
everything like that. I kind of modify all their lifestyle in order to build a wellness platform for them.
Okay.
And it's all about to have not just the rest of their life, but the best of their life.
Ah, is that your, did you make
it's
that motto
yeah,
up?
Yeah, I kind of did. I'm sorry.
I love when people come up with a good tagline.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, so tell me the type of people that would come to you. Like, say I go to the doctor. Of course, I need to lose weight. They say, okay, you need to lose weight. Then I would call you up and say, okay, you need to put me on an exercise program. Mm-hmm. Plus, I have inflammation. So I would come to you and tell you all my problems I
you
have.
You would.
Okay, like I think I'm having some early arthritis.
So exactly.
Now, how are you different than a physical therapist?
The difference between me and a physical therapist, or my practice and a physical therapy practice, is physical therapy does use therapeutic exercise to reduce inflammation and to promote range of motion. What they do also is passive. So in other words, they'll take your limbs and move them. They'll use ultrasound and they'll use other modalities to reduce the inflammation in your joints or whatever they're trying to heal. I do not do passive. Everything I do is active. And so the goal is to have the client have an independent program that they can do their own. And certainly the programs I design do reduce inflammation because sometimes it's just adding certain exercises that stabilize certain muscles to support a joint that's needed.
Mm-hmm.
So, I build on that program and we find for every client, it's something different.
Mm-hmm.
We use a protocol to start with that's based on the condition, but then we modify it based on what the client tells us, what feels better. Every time they come back, it's like, what felt good and where did you get better and where did you not?
They would come to your office. Is it an office?
I call it a practice because it is a practice.
So there's mats on the floor?
Well, if they come, yes, everything's there. All the equipment is there for everything they do. All the equipment I use is equipment that they can purchase for a nominal amount for their own home.
Mm-hmm.
And so the goal is to, for example, if a client wants to start playing golf again or tennis again, that's our goal. And their program is set up in that manner. If they want to return to a gym environment and then exercise with others, their program is geared towards that.
Okay, so what kind of diets do you prescribe for somebody who just wants to lose weight versus a diabetic? Or
again,
different kind of diets?
Definitely.
Depending on what yeah. the issue is.
The first question I ask is, what do you love to eat? Mm-hmm. Because I build that into every diet. Mm-hmm. There's no sense, if you tell me I have to eat Panucci fudge, because that's one of my favorites, I'm not going to say to you, you can never, ever have Panucci fudge. Mm-hmm. We're going to work a way that you can have some Panucci fudge in your diet. Mm-hmm. And that's, of course, saying you're not a diabetic and you don't have blood sugar issues. Mm-hmm. So I take what you love and I build a program around that. Mm-hmm. I usually find that people, a lot of diet problems are from inconsistency, from being too hungry at mm-hmm. the wrong times. Mm-hmm. And therefore, they're reaching for a food that's not the best for them. Mm-hmm. And really, every single meal you eat, even if it's a small meal during the day, should be a combination of proteins, carbohydrates, and fats.
So you're not one of these people that says no carbs in your
Absolutely
diet?
Absolutely not. You need carbs. Carbs mm-hmm. provide energy to the body.
So you let people have bread?
Of course.
If they need to.
Whole grain bread is awesome.
Right.
Yes.
Well, why don't you go ahead and make me do some exercise.
Okay. We're going to get going here.
And what is, tell me what we're going to do. Or you're going to do that by yourself, right? Because you don't have extra those.
Well, I'm going to have you do them.
Oh, gosh.
Okay. So we have these, and these are to pretend like you're jumping rope, which is great. I mean, some of us, I just turned 60 a couple weeks ago.
Oh, wow.
And a lot, you know, most 60-year-olds probably don't decide to jump rope. I just decided to jump rope right before my 60th birthday. I decided it was time. So I jumped as a child, and now I'm jumping again. But for people that aren't ready to actually jump an actual rope, or they don't have the room in their ceiling, what you can do is you can turn on music and do this, and you can change where you go with it. And I'm going to have Lisa do it to show that.
Oh, my gosh.
Even if you don't have experience, you can do this.
I can do this.
Okay.
So I'm just doing this. I'm yeah. supposed to yeah. do this to
yeah.
music.
Yeah.
But I'm supposed to be jumping.
Well, you're supposed to be jumping or marching in place. And it's a great
okay.
warm-up and everything like that.
And then I jump back.
And you bring your arms out. So
okay.
we really work those
right.
shoulders,
I don't
want to
hit
deltoids.
You on the face, but,
yeah.
Okay. Oh, so, so this does stuff for my arms, not just me exercising by jumping.
You can use it in so many different ways that you even exercise your pectorals. You know, there's so many things that you can do to work different muscles of the body. And primarily, you know, you're not going to build a lot of strength doing this, but you are going to be able to work range of motion.
Okay.
And also, you know, get some upper body things going on here.
Do you have an exercise video where we can watch you, a whole video?
What I do is for every client that needs additional instruction. In other words, if they come to me and they're like, I have a hard time exercising, remembering the program, even though you write it down, I have a hard time remembering what this means, I make them a personalized YouTube video.
Do you?
Yes.
Oh, that's wonderful.
So they just reference that YouTube video and all the exercises are there for them.
Oh, okay, so you doing it on the video.
That's correct.
No,
yes.
You say, okay, Marcia, get going.
That's what I do. I said, it's time to get fit. That's right. And they often send me an email and go, that was the best. You know, just to have the YouTube video, just to review the exercises. Because remember, a lot of clients I have, Lisa, many have never had an exercise program in their life. You know, mm-hmm. they might have had a busy life when they were younger. I mean, remember, some people that older, you know, they used to hang up laundry. Well, guess what? Hanging up laundry on a clothesline and taking it down and folding it is a lot of exercise.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't do that anymore. So we're kind of missing out.
Right.
But these, you know, whether it's women or men, obviously men were pushing wheelbarrows and things like that. But they might have had a structured program where mm-hmm. it's like, oh, I'm going to go to the gym or I'm going to do that. That doesn't mean they're not fit. But at different stages of the lifespan, we need to build different skills.
Mm-hmm.
And so, for example, when we get through the lifespan, let's say age 50, 60, 70, we need to build balance and proprioception. Now, that's not to say we're going to neglect cardiovascular health, flexibility, or strength, but so important to start thinking about balance and proprioception, mm-hmm. which is how you move through space,
mm-hmm.
to prevent falls.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a big concern that I have, and it's a big thing that I focus on with certain clients.
Okay, now what do we do with these heavy things?
Okay, these
and I get the pink one, thank you.
Do. You do, you're welcome.
I like the
These
pink.
Are called kettlebells.
Kettlebells?
Lisa got a 5 pound, so I knew she wasn't a lightweight, okay? I gave her a decent size one. Could have been as low as 3, but I didn't go there. And you can do these exercises when you start with absolutely nothing. You can have a water bottle, okay? It doesn't have to be a kettlebell. And a lot of these exercises we do standing, and obviously when we do them standing, we're doing different things with our legs. We're doing side squats, we're doing lunges, we're doing different things that make it more aerobic. But right now, we're just gonna work out in the chair, nice and easy. And I know you have a skirt on, so we're gonna, what we're gonna do actually, we're gonna start with an exercise, and I always like people to sit out on their chair a little bit, because what that forces them to do is pull in their core muscles and their abdomen and support their back, and they can't slouch, okay? You gotta sit nice and tall, shoulders up, back and down. And what I'm gonna ask Lisa to do, she's gonna lift the kettlebell, she's gonna drop it onto the left side of her knee, and onto the right side of her knee. And onto the left side, I'm not gonna hit the table again. And on this side.
And we're what does this do for me?
We're working our core right now.
Ah, okay.
Yes. So we're working our oblique muscles and our deltoids. They're getting nice and fit, right?
Yeah.
Isn't that great?
Gosh.
And eventually make it bigger and bigger. And that's a great exercise, don't you think?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Looks easy too.
It does. We can also do rotations. It's like this. And again, this is actually very good for the posterior core. So those are the muscles in the back, like the serratus and the trapezius. And very important to build those muscles to support your core. Many people ignore them. They think, gee, if I work on my core, that's all abdominal. It's not. You have, obviously, your rectus abdominis, transverse abdominis in the front, but you have these muscles in the back that are equally important. And by strengthening these, you have much less chance of having lower back issues.
Okay.
So it's an important thing to consider.
All right.
So that's just what, we can do behind the head and down.
Wow.
So, and here we get the tricep. Okay. So there's a lot of things that we can do, which is great. Some things we can do with no equipment whatsoever. I'll just take that from you.
Okay.
Thank you. Is we can use these bands. And these are really versatile. I'm just gonna show, obviously I don't have a doorknob nearby, so I'm just gonna put this on my foot. And you can simply just pull up and down, pull up and down, get some arm work in there, or you can extend and bring your knee into your chest, okay? Or you can hold that there and simply do some flexion and work that hamstring, which that's important because many people, again, as we get older and we take shorter steps, we move more slowly. We diminish the size of our gluteal muscles and our hamstrings. And when we do that, it actually makes this stronger. But again, it leaves us susceptible to falls. So really important to strengthen and lengthen the hamstring as we go through the lifespan.
So that's why I always see runners and walkers doing this stretching where I see them stretch, like stretching out.
Yeah, you want to stretch it. Of course, runners, a lot of runners do have an imbalance of the quadricep to the hamstring. Even them, they're very active, and yet the hamstring becomes underdeveloped. So even that's even important for a runner. The only way that we can do it in an active motion without using some sort of being like a strap or something like that is to actually run or walk backwards. And I do that with all my clients.
Really?
Yes.
How can you run backwards and not fall into anything?
You do it slowly at first. And you always investigate your space and make sure that you're in a safe spot, definitely.
So how did you get into doing this?
Well, the interesting thing, I mean, the two reasons why my business is named Encore, the first reason, of course, is all about the clients that I'm trying to reach and assist on their journey to wellness. Core means many things. So not just the core of the body, but it's the core of your life should be about health. Like they say, the greatest wealth is health, right? So I think that's the core of any wellness program, so that's why I named it that way. But the other thing is, this is my Encore career.
So this is a second career, third career.
It's actually like a fourth career.
Fourth career. Right. What were you doing in food? You
said I was a food scientist.
You were a food scientist. So this is why you can really prescribe diets and people can take you seriously.
And I have a bachelor's and master's in nutrition and food science.
Okay.
So I do have credentials to support that.
All right.
Okay, I'm not a certified diabetes educator. If someone had something uncontrolled, I certainly would send them to the proper people for that sort and maintenance. But when it comes to weight management and, just everyday tweaking people so they lose a little bit of weight.
Right, you were educated in that.
Exactly.
And you worked in that. And what did you do in the pharmaceutical industry?
I was in pharmaceutical sales for 10 years.
So that's why you know a lot about drugs.
I do. I've sold a lot of classes. So I've sold cardiovascular, osteoporosis, gastrointestinal products, psychiatric products. And I spent a number of years in ophthalmology, which I absolutely adored. That was really great.
Why?
I just think the eye is the most fascinating thing. I mean, just learning just how intricate eyes are, and it's just amazing. It's just an amazing
thing. So it just
thing.
Sounds like, that's what I like about this idea of you being able to really help people with their drugs, because a lot of times I used to go to a pharmacist every time I was taking something or prescribing something. I had a medically needy daughter, and I had to take a lot of things. Plus, I was trying some stuff on my own, some herbal things, and I knew I had to make sure that it wasn't going to interact with the drugs. So you're kind of like a full service.
I am.
And you know, for the overall health that you want to be maintaining.
Yes. I mean, I do have a lot of knowledge about a lot of medications people commonly take, about the side effect profiles of them, the interactions with other medications. Do I know of everything? No. But I certainly know who to contact if I don't. You know? So I have resources. My sister is a nurse. She has actually was a nurse case medical manager for over 30 years, and she assists me as well.
Oh, okay, that's great. Now, do you give group classes, or is it just one person at a time?
You know, it totally depends. I mean, I do have some classes that are in the morning at 8 o'clock right now that are group. There's six people.
Oh, so they, so people could go to your website and find out. Now, what is your website again?
Yeah, it's www.encore. Nothing's capitalized.
And it's up there on the screen.
Yes,
okay.
fitwell.com.
And they can look to see if there's a class
What's
or if they
offered.
Just want to come in. You know, at what are your hours? Are you open 7 days a week,
well,
6 days a week?
Well, I'm open 6 days a week. However, I do go see clients. So I do prefer that people call me in advance to make sure I'm not with an off-site client. But I will say this. Every client, when they come in, whether they join the group class or whether they individual instruction, you can also share instruction with a friend or a spouse.
Oh, that sounds fun.
Yeah, so even if you had two friends, three people could split the cost. It'd be very reasonable.
Well, that's a great idea.
And you know, we just kind of meet everybody's needs. But we do a musculoskeletal screening prior to anyone starting, because I assess everybody for their joint stability, for pain, for range of motion, and make sure they're appropriate for exercise. Because if they're not, I send them back to their doctor or to the physical therapist.
Okay. All right. What other things can people expect? Like, that was a fun thing idea that you had with your friends. What gives you the most personal satisfaction? Or, like, you're also a personal trainer, right? Like,
well, I'm not.
You did sports.
Yeah, I was a coach for many years.
Oh, what'd you coach?
So I actually was the head coach at Brookfield High School for boys track and field.
Oh my gosh, did you see that movie? That's out.
I haven't seen it, and I definitely want to see that.
Oh my gosh, it's
just
so nice, because there's so many dark stories out there.
Yeah.
So not only is this true, but it's inspiring.
Yes, and you know what? To be honest with you, I can't think of any dark moments in track and field. It's just, no, it's just a beautiful sport. It's just, even the other team, there's so much support among the young men for each other, and they make such friendships through the schools, and there's no adversarial thing. Everybody wants to do their best. It's really awesome.
So you like being a coach then?
I miss a lot. I really do.
So, but you're now a coach just for smaller groups.
Exactly.
You're still a coach. Like, are you the tough coach that yells at everybody?
No,
you don't look like, you don't look like the type that yells at everybody.
I'm very nurturing. I feel that there isn't enough nurturing in this world, and I need to provide that to my clients, because I think it's all about feeling safe to take risk. And it's like, I'm encouraging to take a risk, to step a little out of their comfort zone and say, yes, I can do this. Yes, maybe a lot of people told you couldn't, but I'm going to set a goal for you, and we're going to try to achieve it. It's really important.
Now, do you have any sports that you recommend to people that you think is easy on the joints, or?
Swimming, obviously.
So swimming?
I mean, swimming, but it's not for everybody.
Right.
You know, some people simply don't enjoy it, so I wouldn't encourage them to do it if they really
don't.
How about
rowing? Like, there's a lot of,
you know,
kayaking, rowing.
Rowing is good. The only thing, a caution about that, it would be the same as running or pursuing any sport exclusively. There's always a chance of overuse injuries. So I tell people, especially as we move through the lifespan, you notice I don't use the word aging. As a gerontologist, I will not use that word.
Oh, that's right. You were a gerontologist.
I am a gerontologist.
Or you are. What does that mean exactly?
A gerontologist is someone who studies the lifespan.
Okay.
So some people would say, oh, it studies aging. Well, I would contend that we are aging from the moment we're conceived. A lot of people use aging and use it in a negative way. You know, it's like anti-aging. How is that not negative? I mean, you're basically saying aging is bad. I'm anti that.
Right.
So I won't use that.
Well, you know, you have beautiful skin from the age you just told me. So how is it that you're staying so, I forget, that I'm not allowed to say aging, but whatever.
Sorry. How are you life spanning so well?
Yeah, how are you life? Yeah, really. Tell me. What do you think?
I think it's a combination of three things. And one thing that being a gerontology student taught me is there is a synergy between the physiological, the psychological, and the sociological. And what that means is anything that happens to your body is also happening to your mind and also to your community, to the community that supports you. So we need to recognize that. And I think that kind of makes me more whole, knowing that if I take care of my body, probably the rest of my world is going to go well as well. So I think it's just, you know, part of its attitude. I'm fortunate I come from a family of very positive people. My dad just passed away last year at the age of 96.
And wow.
He was my role model. He mowed his lawn and shoveled snow till pretty much a month before he passed away. So, you know.
So you grew up athletic, it sounds like.
I did. I was a tomboy, and my parents were extremely embarrassed when I ran on the boys' track team in high school.
Really?
And what
happened
to my track
meets?
Well, because girls didn't run.
Really?
And, yeah. This was before Title IX. That's why I tell girls today, I'm like, be so grateful for the opportunities that you have. We didn't have them.
Wow.
Title IX was passed in 1972. That's
what
the year
is that?
I graduated. Title IX is equal opportunity in sports for boys and girls.
Because, you know, it was funny because my daughter was in field hockey. I guess I didn't have a boys' field hockey. She was in high school on the girls' field hockey team.
Yep,
so it was a little unusual.
It is unusual,
that.
But you know, I celebrate that. I think it's wonderful.
I can't remember if he wore that skirt or not. I can't remember.
Well, you know, in Scotland they wear kilts, and that's
right.
What it is. They're wearing a kilt.
Right, they're
playing
wearing
field
a kilt.
Hockey. So I don't have a problem with that, really.
Okay, so
that's good.
So you were one of the few that was, or the only one, you said, running.
I was the only girl on the boys' team. Yeah. So and I wasn't allowed to compete in competition. I could only run with them in training.
So do you think people, depression could be relieved if people took care of their bodies?
It's clinically proven.
It's clinically proven.
Evidence-based medicine shows that exercise alleviates depression. Now, that's not across the board. You still might need some medication.
I
would never recommend that someone discontinues their medication.
Mm-hmm.
I encourage doctors to collaborate with me
and other
healthcare professionals. For every client I have, I write a detailed report based on my assessments. I give that to the client, which I would love for them to share with their doctors.
So what kind of, say somebody suffering from depression, what kind of exercises, assuming they don't have some limiting ability, is there something that you like, I really recommend they walk? Do you have certain things?
I ask them questions like, do you prefer to be alone or do you prefer to be with people? And if they're depressed, I might say, what did you used to prefer?
Okay,
because they might have changed their whole social realm on the basis of having this depression. So I'll go back and say, what did you love to do as a child? Really? And if they said, I love to walk in the woods as a child, I'm going to, and even they say, I love to climb trees. I'm like, well, we might not do the tree thing, but we're going to go for a walk in the woods. You know, we're going to try to recapture.
When you say we, do you mean you walk?
I'll go
walk,
with them.
You walk with them
sure,
in the woods.
Sure.
Oh, okay.
I'll do whatever.
Oh, so
it
you
takes.
Like you will attach yourself to some. Like
if someone
if
needs
so, it's
that?
Not just going to their house and doing exercises
absolutely
with
not
them. You might go for a walk with them.
Yes.
Oh,
yeah. I'll take them to the beach.
Okay.
Yeah. Whatever gives them the ability to say, yeah, I feel better and I want to do more. Because when people feel better, they do more.
Right.
You know, and I don't. It doesn't matter whether it's depression, it doesn't matter whether it's osteoarthritis in their knees or back pain. Once they start to feel better, they want to do more. And by doing more, they're going to return to their health.
So that sounds like a great way for even if somebody didn't feel like exercising, they might want to come to you and say, you know what, maybe she doesn't sound mean, like she'll take me to the beach.
You know what, the rule for me is I do the program with them. Every single client says the time goes by like that. It just flies.
Now, we only have a few minutes left, so
sure.
I want you to share with me things that are on your heart that you wish people would know that you're passionate
Lisa,
about.
Lisa, I think I wish people would know the potential they have within them, even after having an illness or an injury or neglecting their fitness. Perhaps they were caring for family members. There's many, many people out there, I'm sure you know, they're caring for you know, an aging parent and children, mm-hmm. and maybe even a grandchild, and they're right. overwhelmed, and they're thinking, you know, that's the last thing on my mind is to do a fitness program. And right. yet now their health is starting
to decline. It's
suffering
because they haven't been doing.
So I contend that by caring for themselves, they're demonstrating care for their family because they're going to be more available. They're going to have more energy. Their spirits are going to lift everyone else.
So to you, you consider it a priority. You know, like some people might consider, I don't know, yoga or reading the Bible every day or mm-hmm. some sort of something every day. You really feel like part of your everyday, I really should be doing what? How many minutes? Like if you had to...
It's different for everyone. Mm-hmm. It could be as short as 15 minutes. It really could.
Okay, so you don't have to bite off huge chunks.
Not at all.
You could say, but in your mind, that should be one of those things that people should do as
yes.
part of their daily. Do you recommend in the morning or evening?
Depends on the client. I would say most people think the morning is better because then obviously it's done. It's out of
done.
The way.
Mm-hmm.
And they do feel better throughout the day. They have more energy. So
okay. So if you can do something in the morning, that's the ideal way. And that should be part of your daily routine, really. Because
exactly.
you don't consider it just part of your physical health. You also consider this part of your mental health.
That's right. And you know what? It should be just like brushing your teeth.
Okay.
It really should. Just like we don't expect a dentist to have to remind us to brush our teeth every day.
Right.
Really, that's what we need, especially today, because there's so many reasons to sit down.
Right.
I mean, think about it. I mean, there's TVs, there's computers, there's the car. There's so many reasons to sit down. We need to find some reasons to stand up and get moving.
Right. So you have some of those little things, but you said you can... Your home is filled with things you could be lifting or
well, of course.
Like water bottles.
I mean, I can show them many, many demonstrations of things that they can do with no equipment.
With no equipment at
all. With no equipment at all.
Okay, well, thank you so much. Tell us again your website again.
Sure, it's www.encorefitwell.com.
And there's your phone number up there.
Yeah, thank you.
Now, that must be your cell number, and that must have been when you lived somewhere else.
I lived in Brookfield.
In Brookfield.
Yes.
Okay, and that was your area code then?
It was 203, and I just find, you know, once you have a cell number, it's kind of like a part of your personality. So I almost think if I changed that, I would have withdrawal. So
right, because my cell number is from New York. So sometimes people don't answer my call because they say 845.
Yes.
Why am I getting a call from area code 845?
Exactly.
You know, so I do miss things because of my area code. But eventually people get used to it and they'll get used to your area code.
I hope so. And I hope some people come out to visit me at the Spindrift Village and get assessed for the musculoskeletal screening. And see where that goes. And again, there's no obligation, but I'd love to meet everyone.
Oh, that would be great. They can come with no obligation just to meet
definitely,
you and see
definitely.
Your... Okay, that's good
yeah.
to know.
I just want people to come in and say hi, have a cup of tea. I have a little seating area. We have tea,
okay.
we chat.
Okay, so they
it's
can
fun.
Just, in case they're afraid to jump in, they can come
yeah.
for no obligation kind
no
of...
No pressure.
Just to meet you, see
yeah.
the space, and
yeah.
kind of figure you out.
Exactly.
So, and I love your YouTube video, your exercise. That's really great that you do that.
You.
Well, thank you so
thank
much for coming.
Thank
it's
you,
great
Lisa.
To meet you.
A pleasure. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. Thank you so much for joining us on the Lisa Saunders Show, and I look forward to seeing you next week.